Truth Connections.
Question is, what's real, what's deception? What should we pay attention to? What is it that's driving us insane?
Truth Connections.
Something happened in here.
Truth Connections.
Hello, hello. This is Catherine Buckaloo, and you are listening to Truth Connections Radio. And we are broadcasting from UPRN 107.7 FM, the Paranormal Radio Network, and truthconnections.com. Thank you for being here. I don't have any clever quotes to begin tonight's broadcast. I can only speak from my heart and say that we live in a world, a society, where satanic ritual abuse, pedophilia, and trauma-based mind controllers rule the world. To me, these topics are at the core of why our planet is in such distress. When a child suffers, generations are affected. Our karma as a whole is also affected. Tonight's show is about satanic ritualistic abuse, and our guests are Jay Parker and Mark Passio. Jay and Mark were keynote speakers at both Free Your Mind events that were held in Philadelphia. Jay Parker was born into a multi-generational satanic Illuminati family. During his most formative years, he suffered trauma-based MONARCH mind control. In effort to continue his own healing process and help others along the way, Jay hosts his own blog talk radio show called SRA Today. That's short for Satanic Ritualistic Abuse, with the Type 1 Radio Network. Please help me welcome Jay Parker to the show. Welcome, Jay.
Well, thank you, Catherine, and it's a pleasure to be here. And we are speaking about one of the most important subjects in the world today, the subject of mind control.
Yes, sir. And I'm very grateful that you're here. It's great to talk to both of you again. Next up is Mark Passio. Mark is well-versed in the study of Kabbalah, the Church of Satan, the occult, occult symbology, and natural law. He brings a unique perspective on its deception, the magic and sorcery behind it, and the underlined agenda of mass manipulation that's going on. Mark hosts his own show called What on Earth is Happening, about many topics ranging in diversity. Please also help me welcome Mark Passio to the show. Welcome, Mark.
Kathy, thank you so much for inviting me to be on the show this evening.
You're very welcome. If you guys don't mind, I'd first like to begin giving a little bit of your bios. So Jay can begin when he's ready and tell the audience a little bit about himself.
Thank you, Catherine.
You're welcome.
It's a pleasure to be here.
Thank you.
The most important subject in the world today is the subject of mind control, the manipulation of individuals and society. I grew up in a multi-generational satanic family. My mother and father were both cult members. My father's ancestors joined the Illuminati in approximately 1720s, well before Adam Weishaupt supposedly formed the Illuminati in Bavaria in 1776. The Illuminati, to my knowledge, goes back to Babylon and even before then, to the previous age on Earth, the age of Atlantis. In fact, my father and his occult friends would refer to themselves as Atlantean warlocks. And so we're talking about this going back at least 200,000 years, maybe even more. The dark occultists, to my knowledge, have always been prevalent in society, the steerers and manipulators of society through religion and finance. And basically, the rest of the human race are their cattle. Let me go into a little history of my personal family and also Illuminati history that I was taught when I was being groomed to be a member of the Illuminati when I was a child. Basically, my mother can trace her satanic heritage back 3,000 years, mother to daughter witchcraft, to the Amalekite people of the Middle East. The Amalek are spoken of in the Old Testament. King Saul was ordered by Jehovah to kill all the Amalek. But a story I was told when I was a child was that when the Jews and King Saul were slaughtering the Amalekite, basically what they did was they disobeyed God. They decided instead of killing all the people and all the cattle and sheep, they decided to herd the cattle and sheep and use them for sacrifice to Jehovah. This was not the orders that were given by Jehovah. And so my mother's story to me when I was a child learning true history about Atlantis and about the dark occult was when the Amalekite herds were being rounded up by the Jews in the valley of the Amalek, a caravan of Amalek coming from Egypt into the valley saw the slaughter and slipped away to Moab, which is modern-day Jordan. And that's why you'll find, even though supposedly Saul killed all the Amalekite, 300 years later in the Old Testament, you're finding that the Jews are fighting the Amalek once again in Jordan.
Right.
Or Moab, as it is called. And that's why, you know, we even see the term Moab today in the mother of all bombs. I do not know when the Jews, the dark occult Jews, and the which are the Ashkenazi Jews, the Jews that actually run Judaism for their own selfish dark occult interests. They are not the Torah Jews. They are a dark cult of Atenists. And Michael Tesserion goes in very much detail, and so does Jordan Maxwell, into the Atenist religion. It's basically the worship of the negative sun, Akhenaten, all that stuff. I'd rather Mark talk about things like that and me just sit here for a moment and just talk about what I went through as a child and what's going on in the world today.
Yes. How old were you when this all started? I know you remember quite far back.
My first memory of abuse that I can still remember was my father forcing me to fellate him in the cradle. So if you want to know more about, you know, the details of trauma-based mind control in the 10% of the American people who are dark occult, who are satanic generational families, I recommend an author by the name of Fritz Springmeier, and two books which will enlighten you about the dark occult in America today and who's running the show. The first book, which is more of a political economic book and a history book of the Illuminati in America, is Bloodlines of the Illuminati. Bloodlines of the Illuminati has a lot of Fritz Springmeier's research in it, but also there's a awful lot of Jordan Maxwell's research in that book, according to Jordan. And I just wanted to give Jordan his props, because Springmeier does not really mention Jordan Maxwell in the book Bloodlines of the Illuminati. But in fact, Springmeier used a lot of his research. And that goes into the major 20 major Illuminati families in America: the Rockefellers, the DuPonts, the Morgans, the Warburgs, you know, the whole gang on Wall Street and in Washington, and the big players in the military industrial complex.
Yes. Before we go to Mark, if you don't mind, explain for the audience why they take a child from birth to 6 years old. I think it's a very important thing to mention, why they do most of their trauma-based mind control at that age.
I'm going to talk directly to the my mother said it was 12% of the American people who are the minions of the dark occult elite, the minions who formed the police, who formed the working members of the armed forces, who are the judges, the teachers, the professors, who steer society in the wrong direction. Later in the next hour, I'm going to really break down reality to them and talk to them personally from what I've studied in the last 14 years since I broke my mind control programming. But in the case of my parents, I just want to say that both of them were school teachers. Both of them were lifelong pedophiles and human sacrificers. Both of them, my father is still alive to my knowledge, but my mother did pass away. Both of them were born into a system that, from my research and my mother's talking to me, not only is there sexual abuse in the cradle, like what I went through with my mother and father, but there is also in vitro electroshock given to the fetus. And to understand human development, one of the best, most concise lectures on human development and the repercussions in your adult life is a work done by Bruce Lipton. Bruce Lipton is a microbiologist, now retired, and he's an author and lecturer, who in 1968 was working on stem cells. So we're talking about a guy who was in the highest reaches of science. And he has done a work called Wisdom of Your Cells. It's an audio lecture of about 10 hours. And he takes all the knowledge of biology that he learned by being a top-rated microbiologist for over 35 years. And he breaks it down in a 10-hour lecture and tells you how and why the human works the way they work. And essentially, in a nutshell for right now, I will say this, that 95% of your beliefs, your filtering of information in your adult life, and your wishes and desires, your prejudices, are placed in you when you are 1 to 6 years old. In the time you're 1 to 6 years old, a human being, all human beings, are in what is called a hypnagogic trance. You cannot differentiate any information that is being absorbed by your five senses. You simply take everything in verbatim like it's God's truth, okay? Because you have to get a ramp up when you're about 6-7 years old in brainwave pattern to actually begin to differentiate knowledge and decide whether you're going to believe something or not believe it. And I know that sounds strange, but for 6 years, you're in a hypnagogic trance.
No, it makes total sense, Jay, because, you know, children at that age, even in vitro, the mother, the amount of stress the mother has emotionally, physically, can be put right into that child. And, you know, children from the ages of 0 to 6 don't have their reasoning skills. They don't understand what's going on. So they would just absorb it, and absorb it, more importantly, through the subconscious.
Well, it's the building of the subconscious. And basically, in Wisdom of Yourselves, Bruce Lipton talks about the hypnagogic trance, the building of the subconscious, which is the main computer that runs your life. The conscious mind, the everyday thoughts and feelings, is about 5% of your life. The other 95% is all subconscious. And so by having a system like trauma-based mind control, basically you get in there and you, through trauma and through abuse, you steer the consciousness. And you get people to understand that you don't have anything in this world but the cult. God has forsaken you, and you're a child of the cult. And that's the way it is. End of story. Now, I can say for a fact that there is a free will decision in becoming Illuminati. And it's made at a rather young age. But if you do not wish, like when I was growing up in Arden, if you didn't want to become cult, simply after you became 6 years old and you were more aware of your surroundings and you were no longer in a hypnagogic trance, they would stop abusing you. They would stop taking you to the rape rooms. And basically you were told, keep your mouth shut. Don't talk about this. And if you don't want to be involved in this, once you're old enough, you can move away from home and go live your life, and we'll leave you alone.
Well, that makes a lot of sense, because I come from a family that has, you know, seven grandchildren, from my brother and my sister and myself, and I saw in all of them, by the time they reached 7, they got their own opinions, they started speaking their mind more, and it's quite ironic that, you know, you say what you say today, because that makes total sense to me. They become their own person around 7 years old. They get their own thoughts, their own opinions about things. And it's quite remarkable to see. I've seen it in, like I said, quite a few kids. Now, they do that, the trauma-based mind control to children during that age period, because there's a chemical release during trauma. Do you want to just go into that real quick, and then we'll get to Mark?
Yes. Basically, you can put it down this way. My parents said to me when I was like 5 years old, we're into the R complex of the brain. They're into flight or fight modality of the brain.
Right.
They're not into the limbic system. They're not into the higher brain, you know. What is that, Mark?
Neocortex.
You know, I'm doing it. So not into the neocortex, not into the limbic system. They're into the lowest part of the brain, the reptilian R complex, which is fight or flight. And basically, as you grow up for the first 5-6 years, and you're being ritualistically abused, you're watching human sacrifice, you're being raped, you're being drugged, you're being tortured. This warps the synaptic pathways and causes chemical imbalance. And that will be a lifelong chemical imbalance unless you reprogram.
Yes, most definitely. Mark, give us a little bit about your history and why this topic is a passionate one for you to talk about.
Sure. Well, I grew up in a pretty standard Roman Catholic family in South Philadelphia on the East Coast. And in my youth, I pretty much accepted without much question programming that had been handed to me, religious dogma, which I was given by family members and school teachers. And I guess starting in my late grade school and early high school years, I began to question a lot of those dogmatic belief systems and programming. But because I lacked the knowledge of what comparative religion was all about, and I certainly lacked the knowledge of astrotheology at that time and didn't understand how religion was all really an extension of astrotheological cults of the ancient world, that knowledge would have helped put a lot of the religious indoctrination and programming that I had received into perspective. But since I lacked it, my questioning about the religious programming that I had received as a child, that was just, you know, basically transferred to me by rote. It wasn't like it was insidious or, you know, it wasn't anything vicious that was being done to me, but it was just people who didn't know any better themselves passing along their programming, because that's what you do. You know, you just go along to get along, and this is what our parents taught us, so this is what we teach our children. Because I had, you know, lacked that frame of reference in knowledge, my questioning when I approached attempted to approach these topics from a perspective of reason, it didn't have any framework to channel that in a positive direction. So all of it turned to anger, and I, you know, was viciously angry about being lied to, and what I perceived was, you know, just willful deception and kind of, you know, people who didn't care about what the truth was, or, you know, they didn't care about whether they themselves were being lied to, and they were just passing it on by rote. And that anger just kept building and building in me. And what I began to seek was the exact polar antithesis of that religious indoctrination. And I found it in the form of Satanism and dark occultism in general. I began to read into and espouse the satanic ideology as put forward by the group on the West Coast of the United States known as the Church of Satan, through the writings of Anton LaVey. Eventually, some of my own work, when I started writing and putting out some articles espousing the satanic ideology, and then also writing lyrics and in different bands that I was in, also putting out Satanism in that medium, I attracted the attention of LaVey himself. He actually recognized some of my work that I was doing and decided he wanted to appoint me as a priest within the Church of Satan, his organization.
Wow.
So LaVey did that. I accepted it, like, you know, graciously and proudly at the time. And he wanted me to start what's called a grotto. A grotto is what you would call a coven in LaVeyan Satanism. And I didn't really want anything to do with that, because I had kind of looked at Satanism as a very individualistic thing, a very individualistic ideology. And I just really didn't want to be involved too deeply in a group dynamic, certainly not one that I was in charge of. I just didn't want that kind of responsibility. So I kind of always put that on the back burner, even though he had offered that to me. And what I then did was I peripherally became involved in satanic groups in my area who weren't just Church of Satan groups. There was a whole lot of different affiliations and many different groups. It's what I would call just the satanic hierarchy operating locally in the tri-state region in this area. So I started becoming involved in some other, just again, in a small capacity, in a low level capacity, in other grottos in this region. And the states that I was active in was Pennsylvania, of course, Maryland, and Delaware. And as my involvement grew with these grottos, I began to become aware slowly over time that this wasn't just an isolated group of individual Satanists that were, you know, working with some occult knowledge for their own personal reasons. They were a very tight-knit group of people that were comprised of an eclectic array of people from every walk of life and every human social institution that you could possibly think of. Politics, banking, media, military, law enforcement, law, entertainment, medicine, education, technology, entertainment, you name it. Every single possible walk of life, every human endeavor, every social institution, there were Satanists involved in high-level positions and positions of influence and power in all of those organizations. And I realized they weren't working independently. They were working all together. They formed a hierarchy. They formed a hierarchy which worked through a lot of it worked through compartmentalization, with, in many cases, a lot of these groups not knowing what the other groups were doing, you know, and they worked together. They were very, they were tight knit in a way, and in a way at the lower levels, again, there was compartmentalization, and it worked through hierarchy. There were ranks. Okay. It was a very regimented and hierarchical, much like a military organization.
Or Masons or the Illuminati.
Correct. Like degrees in a secret society. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. But the main thing is they weren't working separately. They were working toward a common goal, a common agenda. Their agenda was united. Okay. Even though there were very many groups, the groups were being pulled together and they were working toward a common goal. And that goal was to increase the collective power of the whole network, the hierarchy. Okay. At the expense of everybody's rights and freedoms throughout society, including their own, believe it or not. I mean, they were in, as Jay is going to tell you, they're enslaving their own membership. It's not just that they want to enslave other people and they're just going to magically be free. Only a tiny, small, elite aspect, an apex at the top of the hierarchical pyramidal structure is going to have a modicum of freedom, and everybody else is thrown under the bus and is going to be enslaved. So when I recognized that this was really about a small group of individuals that were trying to take total power and enslave everybody else, I didn't want to be involved in it anymore. When I realized I had become involved at a low level with this kind of an organized syndicate, hierarchical syndicate, I took a step back. There was still a modicum of conscience operating inside of me. And I basically said, I don't want to be involved in this anymore, because while I was about learning about the occult in order to increase, you know, personal power and understand psychology in a deeper way so that you can use that tactical advantage in your life over other people through manipulation, influence, et cetera, what you might call soft techniques of mind control. I was never about slavery, you know. I was never about enslaving other people or right. wanting to be enslaved myself. So when I began to realize that that's what this was really about, and it was working through government, it was working through military, the military-industrial complex, it was working through law, et cetera, to accomplish this agenda, my conscience wouldn't allow me to proceed any further, and I – you know, vocalized it and told some of these people, look, I don't want to be involved in this anymore. And people might think, and as Jay just elucidated, these people will let you just not be involved with their agenda anymore. It's not like people think, like it's like a mafia organization.
Yeah.
There are aspects of that, I would say, that are involved in it. Certainly, I would say the mafia is actually run by these people. But I would say that what they do is, if you express any interest that you don't want to be involved in helping them anymore, they basically say, well, get lost and be enslaved like everybody else, and, you know, just don't bother us. Then there will be retribution, you know, if you try to directly interfere in our plans. But as far as telling anybody about what's going on, they don't care at all. I mean, the attitude when I said I don't want to be involved in this anymore was actually like complete dismissal of my existence. It was like, well, you know, good luck trying to explain to people what you think you know about what's going on here. And, you know, go and bang your head against the wall trying to talk to the dead, the average person that has no idea what's going on, you know, because that's what they call people, the dead, mm-hmm. you know. You know, it was just like, you think we need you? You know, we don't need you, boy. Out you go. And don't let the door hit you on the ass on the way out either, you know. So it was an absolute dismissal. It had not. It was like they projected the idea that they were absolutely unconcerned with anything I could possibly reveal, And I think it was actually a tactical mistake on their part to even take an attitude like that, because there are people coming forward and revealing the mindset of these people, and people can see it more readily in society. They can actually see by this agenda moving forward, creeping forward day by day, that these are satanic individuals, that these are total psychopathic individuals with a religion, and the religion is Satanism. Whether people understand that or not, it certainly is the case. You know, so what I've been doing ever since then is trying to expose what Satanism really is, not what people imagine that it is, not this Hollywood variant of Satanism that is projected by the media and Hollywood. You know, Satanism is something that people very much do not understand what it is at all. Dark occultism in general, people don't understand what it is. They have an idea in their head about what it is, and that idea has very little, if anything at all, to do with what Satanism and the dark occult actually is, and the tenets, the ideological tenets in life that it actually espouses.
Yes. Now, just on the flip side of that, I know, you know, within any cult, there's like a psychological sales pitch going on. Well, what were some of the things that they romanced you to get you involved?
I wouldn't even say it's romancing. They're telling you the truth. They're basically telling you, we understand the techniques of mind control that run the world. They tell you actually openly that Satanists are the rulers of the world.
So they sell you on the power aspect.
In other words, you're going to be groomed to become in that power group if your skills will take you that far. And that's really what they're looking to do. They want to exploit skill sets. It's a psychological vetting and filtration system. That's the best way I have come to describe what the entire satanic hierarchy is. They need people to keep filling the positions, you know, to appoint them into point positions of power and influence in society, so the entire machine can keep rolling along. The whole slavery system can continue to keep going. And as long as people want that in their own lives, they want to be in charge over other people, they want to have power over other individuals, they want to put other people down so that they lose, and, you know, the person who is using these techniques of mind control wins. As long as these people, there are people out there of that kind of a mindset, that is a satanic mindset, to want a power over your fellow human being, people are going to keep filtering into these organizations and being groomed up into these organizations. The people who are tortured under physical trauma-based mind control, who are born into these families generationally, as Jay was, you know, most of them don't make the decision to leave this cult influence, to leave this cult hierarchy or network. They go right in and keep doing the same thing that was done to them. See, it's all about the victim trauma, the trauma victim abuse cycle. You know, I was abused, and I was put through torture, and I was put through trauma. Okay, so I'm going to do that to other people. Okay, and people in society, they've been victimized by the entire system that we live under. And given the chance, would they trade positions with the psychopaths who rule the world? Absolutely. You better believe that they would do it in a heartbeat. 99% of people out there would trade places with one of these satanic psychopaths in a heartbeat if it meant they would have a huge mansion and three Lexuses in the garage and a position of influence and power over their fellow men. And that's the problem. Mm-hmm. Therein lies the entire problem, is at a lower level, the whole population is satanic in their mindset, in their thinking. And that's the whole thing. People have to understand what Satanism really is as a mindset. It's about me coming first before anything else. Self-preservation and self-advancement being the absolute highest aspiration of the individual. And then moral relativism. It doesn't make a difference what you have to do to get up to the top. You know, rights are just – right and wrong is just relative anyway. We make it up. It's not something that actually exists in nature objectively. No, we get to make that up as human beings. You know, well, then if rights – there's no such thing as objective right or wrong. It's a very fast and slippery slope into things like social Darwinism based off – you know, the Darwinian theory of so-called evolution that's all about just, you know, biological material being passed down through time from generation to generation. It says nothing about consciousness advancing, you know. So it's not real evolution at all as far as I'm concerned. It's a flawed theory of so-called evolution. You know, if you could be evolving, I mean, you could be surviving physically and be devolving in consciousness. So is that really evolution? No. you know. But they've taken this into themselves as this left brain Darwinian paradigm, and it then progresses forward through the next tenet of Satanism, which is social Darwinism. You know, you're taking that Darwinian theory of the so-called survival of the fittest, which, you know, gets translated into social terms as survival of the most ruthless individuals comes out ruling the roost. Okay. That's, you know, the third basic tenet, and you take that to its logical progression, and you get the last tenet of Satanism, which is eugenics. That, well, since our biological material got us here and we're in the ruling class, therefore that means we're better than everybody else, and we get to decide who lives and who dies. And that's what eugenics is ultimately about. So self-preservation, moral relativism, social Darwinism, and eugenics. They're the main ideological tenets, and I would postulate and suggest to the listening audience that most people out there have these ideologies as part of their makeup. It's not just the satanic ruling class. They have to get people to buy into what I call mini-me Satanism. Satanism at a lower level, at an ideological level, infused throughout society, completely pervading society. And I would tell you that we live in a satanic society, mindset-wise. The mindset of the average individual out there is satanic. It's about what is I'm going to get for me. How do I benefit? How do I advance? Doesn't make a difference whether it's right or not. That's all relative anyway, you know. Right and wrong aren't objective and absolute. They're just relative. We get to make that up as we go along. And, you know, it's what's happening in society is just fine and dandy. It's just right. You know, the most ruthless should come out on top. I actually hear people tell me that many people think that psychopathy itself, the inability to feel, is a tactical advantage in our world. Because what do you need those pesky emotions for? They're just going to get in the way and make you empathize with other people, when what you really need to be doing is doing whatever you can to get one up on your fellow human being. You know, so most people are in the social Darwinism mindset, and you know, I'd say given half the chance, if they wanted to just eradicate whoever they wanted based on whether they, you know, like their look or like their way of life or not, you know, that they would do it in a heartbeat. They would practice eugenics too. I mean, you could say that's a very, very dark worldview. It's not a dark worldview regarding human nature. I'm telling you, people are conditioned that deeply that this has become their mindset. I'm not telling you that's just how people are. That's how we have become, and that's how we are acting now in the current moment in our world. That's what that mindset is. What has to change for the world to change? But I would not, blow smoke up people's rear ends and tell people that most people in the world today aren't in that satanic mindset, because it is true, and they are.
Absolutely, Mark. You know, I've had you mentioning that just made thoughts come into my mind from back in the day when I was a stockbroker. You know, I was like you. I've never really been good at taking shit from anybody. I've always had my own mind. And when I was a broker, they liked that about me. But they tried to change who I was. They tried to make all those aspects in me swing in their favor. And I wasn't buying it, because, you know, I wasn't going to rip people off. I wasn't going to sell somebody a stock that I didn't believe in. So that's where I had a problem being a broker. So I was eventually told, you know, you're too honest to be here. You're great at raising money, but you're too honest to be here, and you ask too many questions. Bye-bye. You know, so I started feeling icky. You know, I did not like how it was changing my persona, and it really bothered me. Mark, if you wouldn't mind, explain Satanism through the ages. I think it's a good place to do that.
Well, I would say that this goes really back to the priest class of the ancient world, and that whole mindset was given to humanity by the quote-unquote gods. Again, you know, really, this is a much, much huger story and picture, because it goes back to human origins. You know, if you want to understand where the satanic mindset comes from, you have to understand true human origins. And, you know, the whole model of Darwinian biological, macro biological evolution breaks down when we really try to study who we are. You know, we have to understand that there has been intervention in the course of human progression in our evolutionary progression. There's been intervention by beings that are not us, by beings that are not human. And this is a highly unpopular worldview because so many people don't want it to be true. They are attached to a religion called scientism, or they're attached to a religion called creationism. So most people fall, this is what I've been talking about on my show recently, most people fall into these two polarizing dialectics. It's a dialectic. Well, what do you believe in? Do you believe in Darwinism or creationism? And there's never any idea postulated to people that there could be a third alternative or a fourth or a fifth. Okay. I fall into the camp of interventionism. I believe that as humanity is now, is not how we were intended to be by nature or by creation itself. Okay. Yes, there is a process of evolution working in creation, but it is working not just to advance biological material for survival purposes, it is working to advance human consciousness, all consciousness throughout the universe, no matter whether it's human or not, all higher evolved forms of consciousness. And all matter is becoming more and more conscious as the universe moves forward. But if that process is interfered with, and the involutionary force, the force that works against the evolutionary process, is allowed to run rampant because something was in a traumatic way was done to an entire species, and then somehow the will of that species was interfered with. The ordering force, the force that drives evolution forward, once a species becomes conscious enough, once they develop self-consciousness, and once they develop the ability to recognize natural law, okay, so the capacity for holistic intelligence is present in a species, the biological evolutionary process is essentially run, it has essentially run its course, and then you're going into the realm of epigenetics, epigenetic evolutionary progression, which is progression in consciousness. Okay, this is what Darwinian theory leaves at the door. It doesn't talk about it at all. Okay, it's about a more complex and advanced form of consciousness such that we can understand more and more about how the universe works. All right, this force was completely cut off from us through genetic manipulation. When this genetic manipulation was done to humanity, or done to the being that humanity was as it was naturally evolving, okay, we became something other than what nature intended for us, because this other group of beings that did this to us essentially was doing this for their own purposes. They had become imbalanced in consciousness. It didn't make a difference to them. What they were doing was immoral. They went ahead and did it anyway, created a species that should not have existed. And I, again, recognize that's also a very dark worldview to some people, but that's not to say that I think humanity should just disappear, okay? I think it is possible, it can be done, that humanity uses the remaining will that is left to evolve its consciousness willfully on its own. Okay, that's another highly unpopular view, because most people think that's either not possible, or this is some kind of a magical process. The evolution in consciousness is some sort of a magical process that just happens on its own, and it's being driven by some other force that, you know, we have no say in. And my view is right in the middle. Okay, this isn't something that's being done to us. Okay. It's not something that can't be changed. It's something that if we develop the will, we can change it. And that is up to us. And most people don't want to hear that, because what it does is it places this very, very unpopular thing called responsibility firmly on our own shoulders, which is where we don't want it. We want to pass the buck. We want to, you know, abdicate responsibility to somebody else. We don't want to look at, hey, here's what happened in the past. And this, Kathy, speaks to total trauma as well, because we were traumatized as a young species, period. We went through a traumatic childhood as a species cosmically.
Right.
And our parents traumatized us. Our cosmic parents put us through hell, put us through total trauma. If we understand real human origins, we were created as a slave race and put into brutal, barbaric slavery as a species. And we're still in it. We haven't gotten out of that condition. We're still in the total mindset of a slave race. We are still in the total conditions of slavery, even though most people don't recognize it, because they want to think slavery only involves physical chains and shackles.
you know, and it does not. It involves mental bondage. It involves spiritual bondage. It involves coercion. It involves being kept under duress as a people, which we are. It involves the total and complete usurpation of natural rights, which we are completely experiencing. And see, because we never dealt with the trauma that happened during our cosmic childhood as a species and brought that to the surface out of the subconscious mind, out of our ancestral memory, and dealt with it at a conscious level, we're still undergoing that trauma and the cycle is repeating itself. And to go back to your question, how does this fit into ancient Satanism, the history of Satanism? The gods that made us, the so-called gods, gods with a small g, okay, they gave us the systems of religion and the priesthoods because that was the administration system of the ancient world to administrate over the slaves. Well, there weren't enough gods to administrate over all the slaves. The human population was running rampant in the ancient past, just like it is today. So they had to give us a religion. They had to give us religion. And they propped themselves up as the gods of these religions to worship and the gods of all these ancient cults. And then the priest class ultimately realized, hey, we could become an intermediary. We're being appointed as the intermediary between the gods. So that's a high position of power. We could totally exploit these beings' ignorance that are under us, even though they're even our own kind. We're going to exploit that. And we're going to, you know, and you know, also you have to understand it was the hybrid species, the demigods that had bred with the gods. The gods had bred with human beings, these quote-unquote gods. You could call them fallen angels. You could call them extraterrestrials. You can call them extra-dimensionals. You can call them the archons. I don't really care what you want to call them. It's just a label. It's just a name. There's something that's not us, that doesn't have our interest in mind, that doesn't have our evolutionary development in mind, and that is using us as a food source and an energy source. That's all. That's what their interest in us is. And they want to just keep that going. They want to keep that whole process going because they're just sucking from us and we're providing the energy that they require for their survival and their betterment and their interest. So, you know, these demigod species these beings that made us bred with their own creation created a third species, what we might call demigod, I call hybrid species, you know. I would say they were the first ruling class. They were the first priest class as well. And then they had human administrators of their kingdoms, you know, and then these human administrators eventually kept breeding with these gods, you know, eventually the DNA, you know, melded together and there wasn't such a biological drastic difference between them over time, over thousands of years of time. As Jay said, I feel that number is very accurate, what Jay said. 200,000 years is probably where I would place the modern condition of human slavery dating back to at least 200,000 years ago. As he said, and I concur, probably longer than that, but certainly within the last 200,000 years, the human race has been in this condition. And again, these priest classes that developed that were appointed by the gods and the demigods, they eventually became what we would call dark occultism now in today's world. They became these hierarchies and these cults. And they realized what a tactical advantage they had over their fellow man, because if they understood the hidden technology, if they understood the hidden laws of nature, if they understood how human consciousness and psyche operates, if they understood how you know, the hidden physical laws work, if they understood how the hidden spiritual laws work, what I have termed natural law and other researchers have termed natural law, if they understood how all that worked, they could maintain a tactical power advantage over them indefinitely.
And they're doing that through, you know, the continuation of the slave system through the ages is by way of taxes, by way of the court systems, by way of, you know, just having us as slaves without us knowing we're slaves.
Well, if you can give someone a choice and a vote, well, then you can amuse them with the circus that is the tag team wrestling of Republican Democrat for generations.
Right.
There is only one power in this world today, and that is the Illuminati. And it's been that way, if you do the research, for the last 270,000 years. My parents openly discussed the Anunnaki, They openly discussed us being hybrids, of being genetically manipulated. This is the classic Anunnaki story. You can get it from Michael Tazarian. You can get it from especially Michael Tellinger's new book, Slave Species of the Gods. And later in your show, if I can get like a half an hour, I have a presentation I want to do talking to directly to the 34 million dark occultists out there who are keeping this system up, because I've got news for them. They've been thrown under the bus, and the whole planet is going down.
Absolutely. We'll be happy to get to that later on.
Okay.
With both you guys. I mean, this has been a great show so far. I think it's a good time to go to our break right now so I don't get into another topic. Okay, everyone. During the break, please feel free to sign up for our YouTube channel or Facebook page. Both are called Truth Connections. And if you're in a position to and would like to donate, please visit truthconnections.com. We would be very grateful. Tonight's break song is by Protetius. More of his music can be found at Reverb Nation. Enjoy his instrumental called Spiritual Warfare. Back in a few minutes with more Jay Parker and Mark Passio.
We'll be right back. You're listening to Truth Connections with your host, Catherine Buckaloo, on UPRN 107.7 FM.
We are back with our very special guests, Jay Parker and Mark Passio. Welcome back, guys.
Thank you.
Thanks, Kathy.
You're very welcome. Jay, why don't you first begin by telling us who is exactly running this show?
Well, being brought up to be ninth generation Illuminati, I was given what is considered in true ancient history the classic Anunnaki story. And in the Bible, they talk of the Nephilim. They talk of the demigods, the men of great renown, the Nephilim. And the Anunnaki, supposedly, according to my parents, conquered the earth, made us, and have been in the background, and through religion and economics and politics, have been running this planet as a slave farm. If you look at the world today, you will see three cities that are not part of the countries that they are situated in. Vatican City, which runs the religious slave system. The City of London, which runs the economic slave system. And Washington, D.C., which runs the military end of the slave system.
Yeah, they even have all their own police forces, right?
It's when you really look at the history of Washington, the City of London, they are all independent of the countries they're in. They are total worlds unto themselves. And I just want to say that I've done a lot of research, like Mark Passio, in getting an understanding of what's going on. But I want to give the listeners out there, because we simply do not have enough time to go into the things I went through. So I'm going to give them some heads up where to find deeper talks about these subjects of trauma-based mind control and ritual abuse. And one of the good sources for this information from myself would be the podcast at whatonearthishappening.com. I've done three shows with Mark Passio, and show number 17, podcast number 17, I go into graphic detail about the physical, emotional, and spiritual abuse I went through in the first 7 years of life. Human sacrifice, sexual raping, being buried alive, all the garbage. Podcast number 17, What on Earth is Happening? And you can get that detail there. I also did show number 100 of What on Earth is Happening, where I went into a little bit more of our current situation in the world and solution think. And I also did podcast number 146 at What on Earth is Happening. And two of my talks at the Free Your Mind conference, both Free Your Mind number one in 2011, which was in Philadelphia. It's on the web for free. You can listen to my one-hour lecture at Free Your Mind One at freeyourmindconference.com. And I talk about some of the abuse, but I also, it's a great lecture for 1 hour because I distilled probably 12 years of research in where you need to go, who, what authors you need to read, what movies you need to see to understand the total scope of slavery in the world today. My second speaking engagement at the Free Your Mind 2, which happened a year ago in the spring of 2013 was the first time I came and I started openly talking about the satanic communities that I come in contact with growing up in an Illuminati family, mainly Arden, Delaware, Rose Valley, Pennsylvania. I have a lot of family who are dark occult that live in Medford, Lakes, New Jersey. And my grandmother made it clear to me that Riverton, New Jersey was also dark occult. But my mother said to me many times, there was just a massive amount of dark occult in Philadelphia. Philadelphia is a major center of Illuminati power. But there are several books I would recommend to people if they want to get their head out of the sand and know about the ritualistic abuse. And two books I would absolutely recommend to study in detail, and I'm talking to therapists that run across this, would be Fritz Springmeier's book, How to Create a Total Mind Control Slave. Fritz Springmeier and Cisco Wheeler, a former mind control slave herself in the Illuminati, Fritz Springmeier deprogrammed her, and they wrote this book together, How to Create a Total Mind Control Slave by Fritz Springmeier. And it's for free on the web. If you Google it, you should probably be able to get a free copy on the web. Another book dealing deeply with dark occult satanic stuff would be Kathy O'Brien's Transformation of America. Kathy O'Brien worked in the White House, and she was a mind control slave during the Reagan-Bush era. She has written two books. I certify that Kathy O'Brien, and she's all over the web if you want to hear any of her lectures. She's at the Free Your Mind 2 conference, and she gives a great talk.
Yeah, it was a great job she did.
Good friend of Roseanne Barr. And the people that Kathy O'Brien talked about, the high occultists in the White House, like George Bush, Senator Byrd, Dick Thornburg. I remember my mother growing up saying, you know, these people are in with the system. So I'm just saying that the truth is out there. It's up to you to become more aware of it. And later in the show tonight, I'm going to give a like 20-minute talk and directly talk to the 34 million dark occultists out there and make an appeal to them to come to their senses.
Absolutely. Now, as you both know, I was at both Free Your Minds. I didn't meet either of you at the first one, but I met you at the second one because I was helping out behind the scenes and in the front of the house. And you and I have a very strange connection that we realized at Free Your Mind. We both grew up in that town that you were just talking about called Arden, Delaware. You know, and I went home and I molded around a lot because, you know, from what you told me, I was 11 years old. I delivered the newspaper to one of your abusers. And I even did musical theater shows at the same venue that the church was down below. So I came home and I molded over quite a bit. And, you know, there were some shady characters growing up in Arden. Lead themselves as being like the artistic type, but they're not really artistic at all. They have deep-rooted satanic ties. Talk a little bit about that, Jay, if you don't mind.
Well, Arden was formed in 1900, the same year as Rose Valley, Pennsylvania was formed. A group of dark occultists from the Academy of Fine Arts in Philadelphia decided to form two quote-unquote art colonies, and one was Rose Valley, Pennsylvania, and the second one was Arden, Delaware. Rose Valley was for the more elite and wealthy, and Arden was for the working class. To this day, my mother said Arden was, during the 1960s when I was there, was 90% dark occult and 10% was regular people that bought the story. It was an art colony. The thing I want to mention here is when I was going to school, I remember in like fourth grade, I asked a child in my class at St. Edmund's Academy to spend a night over sleeping over at my house in Arden. And he looked at me and said, "Oh, Arden, I can't go there. It's all devil worshipers."
Wow.
And of course, I heard this from the monks who taught me. I heard this from students, okay, that I was going to school with. And I would retort back like everybody in Arden is groomed to do. "Oh, no, no, that's because we're all weirdos and bohemians and we're different than you. And that's why you think we worship the devil." But basically, 90%. And I went to an Arden fair around 2000 after I had broken my programming.
Very brave thing for you to do, by the way.
Well, I just wanted to go back and say hi to all the abusers and flip them the bird. And I'm telling you, you know, a couple of them got around me and like, "Oh, you're going to cause us trouble?" And I looked at them and said, "I'm no threat to you." You know, because I understood what the deal was. But the reason I came out in 2011 and started talking publicly about this was because if Kathy O'Brien can talk publicly about this, if people can go to a convention year after year in New Haven, Connecticut for Smart News and have a convention of satanic ritual abuse, okay? And I mentioned this and give you pointers on where to hook up with the people in Connecticut. Then I can stand up for the human race also. Okay? And the reason I came out was, one, I had healed myself through EFT enough of the programming where I was back to being me.
Explain what that is. Is that self-hypnosis?
A lot of people think that it is, but it's actually a form of subconscious reprogramming through acupressure. And you simply tap on acupressure points while you are considering a basic thought or a trauma that you went through. And you can energetically remove the power that that trauma has on you. I mean, I've gotten to the point where I'm not even angry at my father and mother anymore. So
that's great.
You can tell me it doesn't work. I'll tell you, you're not writing down your trauma properly. You're not looking at the different aspects of the trauma and tapping on different aspects of the emotional, physical trauma. It takes work to do EFT properly. But anyone who's a secondary psychopath can cure themselves of being cult by using EFT and also coming out of the mind control that they're in. Because what this system is, and Mark alluded to it so well, was it's basically a system based on selfishness. It's a system based on me, not us, not a holistic viewpoint, but me. It's all about me. I don't care about anyone else. Now, you're groomed that way through the indoctrination of the cult, but deep in your consciousness, there's another thing that wants to come out, and that's called a human being. And if you were to fill your mind with the information that I'm recommending to people who are dark occultists, they can free themselves from being an occultist.
Now, I know just because we're on that topic now, you broke free of a lot of your programming, and what they did to you was they electroshocked you, they raped you, they tortured you from the ages of birth to 6 years old. It's very reminiscent to the Rosemary's Baby movie. It's kind of like eerie. And was that an in-your-face satanic movie?
Oh, absolutely. Dick Gregory says a very interesting thing, and it's true. Hollywood shows you what the elite have done in the past, what they're doing in the present, and what they intend to do in the future. There's a lot of movies that have come out that actually tell different aspects of the true history of the human race.
Oh, go ahead. I'm sorry.
Like the recent Thor movie, you know?
Yeah. And they do that in a way. It's like they're cosmic out. If you're not smart enough to see what they're doing, then that's like their karmic past for putting it in plain sight. If you're not smart enough to see and read the writing on the wall, shame on you. Now, I know that there's some ways that they could trigger you now through hand signals. Can you explain that just a little bit?
Well, there's many different the reason that I actually woke up from my abuse programming was my father was I was a carpenter, and my father was using me to work on his house. And I was doing hundreds of thousands of dollars worth of custom work and getting paid squat. And it got to the point where I was like, hey, man, neither one of my brothers is lifting a finger to help you. And it's all on me, and I'm sick of it. And so I pulled back away from him, he being my number one mind control handler. And as I pulled back away from him, he was not re-triggering the programming through drugs and, you know, the hypnotic phrases and hand signals and stuff like that. So one thing about being under mind control is you constantly need it to be rebooted. So if you're in a situation where you know that you have a history of it, you've got to get away from people that are like throwing down the trident or doing different hand signals, and usually you'll find it's a person who is using you, you know.
Why do you think that so many ET, quote-unquote, contactees, I like to think it's more of a MyLab situation, and some trauma-based mind control victims have the similar recollections, like, you know, a lot of the ET contactees have stories and they keep dreaming about Hitler and stuff like that. Is it because the military is using that in a MyLab situation, using some satanic practices?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, the CIA is you know, it's Illuminati Central. Same with the Navy. I mean, the Office of Naval Intelligence, when you look at the power base of the armed forces in America, the Navy has always been, you know, the number one. You can look and say, well, you know, the other branches of services, nah. The Navy has always been, because that's where the ancient pirate Illuminati families first got their power, was in the Navy. And one submarine has more firepower than all the armies. One modern American submarine has more firepower than all the armies of World War II put together. And that's a Navy vessel.
Right.
And we could talk for days and days. I recommend to people to listen to Mark Passio. Listen to his Natural Law. One of the things that healed me of my programming more than anything was truth. When I realized by hanging around Passio and listening to his material and Michael Tsarion and Jordan Maxwell, because when I woke up, I wanted to find out how my life got stolen from me.
Yeah.
Okay. And I was angry enough to get violent, but I just took that energy of that anger and I put it towards healing, and I put it towards finding out the truth and getting to the bottom of this. That's how outraged I was.
Yeah, it's what Mark likes to call the frequency of truth. Jay, if you don't mind, before we get to ask Mark a few more questions, I think it's interesting to explain the Quaker religion and how it came to be here in the United States.
Do you want me to talk about that?
Whoever would like to.
Oh, I'm well versed in it.
Go right ahead.
This is a story from my dear departed mama. So everybody looks at Pennsylvania and goes, okay, the King of England was having trouble with these hippie peaceniks called the Quakers that were non-denominational. They just wanted to be like Jesus. They, you know, were causing dissension over in England. So what does the Illuminati King of England decide to do? He decides to give a parcel of land bigger than England, Scotland, and Ireland together to his nemesis, the son of a admiral, William Penn. Now, all I have to say is, since, if you know the history of the Illuminati dating back in modern times with the Vatican and the dark Venetian bankers that moved from Venice to Holland, then to England and formed the city of London, it was Henry VIII that sold out England to the New World Order Illuminati. That's why you see so many Tudor style houses in Arden and in other heavily occulted areas.
Interesting.
They like to wave hello at each other, like to celebrate their victories in the past. And that's, they do it through architecture. But let's talk about Billy Penn, the admiral's son who wanted to be like Jesus. Okay. Now, he gets thrown in jail for being a dissident. What does the Illuminati King of England do? He gives him for free a land grant bigger than his own nation and ships him off to Pennsylvania. For free. Okay, excuse me, but I know the Illuminati. And the way the system is this. If you cannot control, your opposition. That's not what you do. What you do is you create your opposition. Your people put on a persona, a mask, and they gather up all the opposing forces, but your people are in the hierarchy of that control system. Okay, just like you see in the political process in America today. You know, people are looking for the Democrats and Republicans to save them. Well, they're two different wings on the same eagle.
Exactly.
And so this is what my mother said, and as far as Penn was an agent, and Quakerism was an agent of the Illuminati. My mother said that Christianity was invented by the Illuminati. And this is stretching back to the Roman emperors and the Pisos. And there are books about it coming out now about the first 200 years of Christianity. And I tell you, it's dark. It's not Jesus and the fishes. It's not love, luck, and lollipops. It's a created mind control system. And as David Icke says, Christianity is Satanism light. They couldn't get people to eat human flesh and drink human blood like the mind control trauma-based Illuminati minions. So to get that energy moving, what they did was they invented Satanism light, where you drink the blood and eat the flesh of your savior, but you're still mimicking a blood drinker and a cannibal.
Yeah, it's a ritual when it comes down to it.
Yeah, but it's not a good ritual.
Exactly.
Yeah. So Penn's got a statue on top of City Hall, okay? And in William Penn's right hand is a scroll. And that is a signal for Freemasons that man, when it's you see a picture of a man or a statue of a man with a scroll in his right hand, that is a Freemasonic symbol, meaning that that man has deep, dark, hidden occult knowledge.
And didn't they also build all the important buildings in Philadelphia on ley lines and sacred ground?
Oh, absolutely. And the talk at Free Your Mind 2 by Ross Beng goes into the mound builders. And my mother used to say that the occult here in Philadelphia region was using the ancient energy left over by the Indians. But in his hand, he has a scroll, okay, which is supposedly the charter. And if you look at the statue in the right context, okay, you see the Admiral's son, and it looks like he's, shall we say, relieving himself of some excess beer. You know?
Mark, why don't you talk about some of the manipulation of energy? Break that down a little bit for us, how they do that.
I think the main way that Satanism manipulates human energy is by getting us to do, Satanists get us to do their dirty work for them. I can see no better place to look at that at than the police and the military. And, you know, I highly recommend people to check out my entire lecture on the occult mockery of police and military. These are individuals that dark occultists in general refer to as their dogs, their pets, those who they just have on a leash and a collar.
Interesting.
That will attack when they tell them to attack, will sit when they tell them to sit. And, you know, you see this in symbolism like the dog tags of you know, the military. You know, you have them being mocked wordlessly through just a symbol. And they wear it as a badge of honor, as if it's something great to aspire to. You know, you're being basically likened to a loyal dog that would never bite the hand of its master.
Yeah.
And being basically told, we are your master, you are our dogs, right there out in the open in symbolism, and people are just too stupid to see it. I mean, how could anybody not see that symbolism of the dog tags as you're being told that you're a loyal pet out in the open by putting the tags of a pet onto a human being? Imagine that. And people still, it's that overt, and people still can't see it and want to tell you it means something else. Because, see, they don't want it to be true. I want to start off, you know, answering this whole, you know, general thing about how they manipulate energy. It's, they have to manipulate perception in order to get us to keep giving them their energy. And the number one way that they do that is they get us to filter reality through this filtration system of what we want to be true or what we don't want to be true. That's like the first way that you can manipulate anybody. If people aren't looking at the world and saying, either this is true or it is not true, and it is up to me to determine whether it's true, not to say, do I want this reality that's being described to be true? And therefore, if I'm uncomfortable with it possibly being true, I have to immediately reject it and say that can't be that way. That's the height of hubris. That's the height of absolute ego. And it's the height of human stupidity to try to say, because I'm uncomfortable with the possibility of the world being this way, it can't possibly be that way.
Yes.
And that's where so many people's minds are controlled from the outset. That means from the very beginning, they're going to reject anything that might possibly support the idea that the world is controlled by dark forces.
Cognitive dissonance.
That's right. They're going to immediately reject the information that they can actually see with their own eyes, because their mind and their comfort level is telling them it can't possibly be that way. I don't want to live in that world. See, and the other aspect of this manipulation, which leads to the manipulation of energy, is you get people to believe that you have to believe in something in order for it to be affecting your life. And, you know, when I try to tell a lot of people about the dark occult and what they're doing,
a lot of the time they'll say, well, I don't believe in that. I don't believe what they believe. And therefore, that can't possibly affect my life. That can't have any possible consequences on my life because I don't believe in it. It's like trying to say you have to believe in hypnosis in order to be put into an inductive trance in hypnosis, which is not true. You do not need to believe in hypnosis for that to be done to you.
Absolutely.
Okay? It's the same things. People insist that somehow you would have to believe in the religion that these people believe in order for it to affect you. Well, I counter that by saying to people, do you need to believe in radical Islam for radical Islam to affect your life? Do you need to believe in radical Christianity for the actions of radical Christians to affect your life? Do you need to believe in the act in the ideology of radical and possibly racist political Judaism for that ideology to affect your life? Do you need to believe in what Democrats believe in for Democrats to affect your life? You know, do you need to believe in what Republicans believe in for what they believe in to affect your life? Of course not. And that's because it's a very simple axiom. It's a very simple principle. These people have their belief systems. They are actively engaged in those belief systems, and their behavior is based upon these beliefs. So they are taking action in the physical world that is affecting other people that is based upon what they believe. You don't have to believe in it for it to have an effect in the world. And I don't even understand, I try to even understand where this notion comes from. And the only conclusion I come to it is a direct method of mind control in and of itself, is to put out the notion, it's important for you to believe in what these people believe in. And if you don't believe in it, then that can't be true then. It can't exist. I can't believe I went to a person. I tried to explain to a person what the occult was. And I'm saying the occult isn't what you think it is, okay? It's about ancient human psychology. It's about how to manipulate the mind of human beings. It's about how to get people to give their actions over to you, the dark occult at least, so that you are so that they are acting as an energy source for you, that they're doing your work for you. You don't even have to act and do anything because you're getting other people through the manipulation of their mind to do your actions for you, to do your dirty work for you. You know, people ask me all the time, how do they escape karma? Well, they escape karma because they're not taking the actions, ladies and gentlemen.
Yeah.
We're taking the actions on their behalf. We're doing their bidding. We're following their orders for a paycheck. And it's just, I'm just doing my job, you know? That's called doing the dark, dirty work of the Satanists who run the world. That's what you're doing. And they're mocking you the whole time. Mocking you the whole time, calling you their animals, calling you their dogs, their pets, and mocking you with symbols and giving you dog tags for a job well done. Job well done, dog. You know, here, take this little trinket. There's your little trinket. Back to your feeding bowl, you know, and sit there, and we'll tell you when the next time to attack is, dog. You know, it's a joke. These people are a joke. Not the Satanists. The people who follow their orders, they're a joke. An utter joke. And all they are is wrapped up in their own ego, wrapped up in their own ego identification. They believe they are their job. You know, and they can't possibly do anything else, you know, can't possibly do any other work, you know, because this is all I know. And that does make them an animal. That does make them a dog. It does make them a pet. I'm in full agreement with what they actually are. It's true. It doesn't mean I like it. It doesn't mean I mock them the same way that these dark occultists mock them. I'm just telling you how they mock them. I'm just saying what they're calling them isn't just their subjective opinion. It's true. They are their animals. They are their dogs. The police and military are the pets of the satanic elite. They are that. It's not just a subjective name that's given to them. Well, in reality, they are that.
This is interesting. I have to interject this, that when I was 6 years old, my best friend in Arden, Brandon Ploner, and I talk about this at Free Your Mind Too, was raped so horrifically that he went septic and died in 3 days. I went to a man who lived down the street from me and asked him to go to the police and get justice for this dead boy. The man went to the police, and the police said, oh, we know what's going on in Arden, but we can't do anything about it. And my mother told me a story about Arden, that in the 1930s, the police tried to shut down the pedophile cult there. Three police were murdered in quick order, and then the cult basically went to the police and said, you want some more? And the police said, no, we're done. I want you to understand that, you know, the truth about what is going on here on the planet is available now because of the web. You can read Kathy O'Brien's Transformation of America. You can read Fritz Springmeier's book, How to Create a Total Mind Control Slave. You can get an insight into what these cults are doing to warp the minds of normal people and turn them into secondary psychopaths. But at the top of this pyramid of power are high-bred generational elites who basically, from what my parents said, you know, can shapeshift into a reptilian. My parents bemoaned that they did not have enough of the corruption to shapeshift into a reptilian. But an interesting thing, because in your preview, you talked about the interdimensionalness of this situation we are facing on the Earth. And we were told as children that the reptilians and the grays, you know, it was all interdimensional. It was not ET, so to speak, but actually interdimensional. I was put through where I was bounced out of this, and I saw the blue pyramids that are the matrix machine that we are living in today. If you understand, and I'm talking to the dark and cold out there, that consciousness runs this. My mom said that this place, it was a consciousness-driven matrix. That is why the elite spend trillions of dollars through the education system, through the religious system, through indoctrination from 1 year old to 6 years old, either trauma-based in the satanic families or soft mind control of society in general.
Absolutely. And I'd like to interject there. There was a link that I posted on Mark's group website, group page on Facebook. And it was a school that in their manual, if you will, they were telling kids how to handle a bully. And what they were saying is, do not stick up for yourself. Do not tell anyone. It's going to pass, just deal with it. And that's a perfect example right there of mind control.
Well, that's called be a good slave.
Yeah, and don't stand up for your rights when they're being tread on. See, it's all about ultimately what this whole system wants to do is to get you to just say yes to everything they want to do. You could call it's mainstreaming. They want to mainstream psychopathy. They want to mainstream the satanic ideology and put it out there as something that's completely normal that people will just accept and say yes to. What they don't want you to do is to use the lost word, the word of all power, the word of all personal empowerment and reclaiming the reclamation of all our natural inherent rights as human beings. And that is the word no. Evil doesn't want you to say no to it. They want you to keep saying, yes, I'll do that for a paycheck. Yes, I'll keep treading on other people's natural rights because I get to keep my position of power.
I'll keep defrauding people because I get to get a leg up over them. You know, I'll continue to beat on these people because I feel some petty sense of power over them because I never felt any real true power in my entire life. You know, that's what it wants you to do. It wants you to keep saying yes and go deeper and deeper and deeper into it. Instead of saying, no, I will not engage in actions that are immoral. I will not engage in actions that cause harm to my fellow human being, which I have no right to take. You know, the solution to all of this is to say no and to refuse to continue to engage in this system.
Yes, someone in the group said they wanted to know what you thought about that. I said, I can tell you what Mark would say. Mark would say, do no harm and take no shit.
That's it.
That's exactly what Mark would say.
That is the center path. Neither an abuser nor a victim. And this is the way of the Gnostic, and it's the way of the true human being, where you go through life learning. And when I look at my parents' lives, okay, and they were good occult minions their entire life. They raped, they killed, they did everything they were supposed to. And you go out on the web, you can hear you can see my videos, and especially look at my Free Your Mind 1 and 2 work. But all I have to say is they did what everybody else in this society is programmed to do. Once they achieved enough knowledge to fill their bellies and put a roof over their house, they stopped learning. They stopped learning. And we are here to grow in wisdom and knowledge and consciousness. That is the true spirit of humanity. And these people in this society, whether you're a cult or not, look at your life and you'll find 99% of the people, when it comes to learning, all they want to do is learn how to make more money. They don't want to learn to become more of a human being. Yeah. They don't want to learn to grow in spirit. They just want to make more money and get more things. And I look at my parents and they plateaued. They got to a certain level where they could take care of themselves, their material needs, and they never learned a damn thing more.
Well, that ties into the patriarchal agenda. Mark, why don't you go into that a little bit?
It's all about the suppression of emotion. It's about, you know, imbalancing people, not only toward just the masculine, but in a way imbalancing us just, again, as Jay said, away from the center path, away from a marriage between the masculine and the feminine. So they need both of these forms of imbalance going on. Of course, to have a male-dominated world, you're going to need to create a whole lot of feminine imbalance. Okay, you're going to have a whole lot of people who aren't willing to stand up for their natural rights and exercise the self-defense principle. But you're also going to need a whole lot of people in balance toward the masculine force, okay, toward the masculine aspect of consciousness, without any sacred feminine quality in there, without any nurturing or compassion, without any empathy for what they're doing to their fellow human beings, because they're the people who are going to do the controlling. So that's what they want, is a world that is imbalanced toward the masculine or the left brain. Those are going to be the controllers. They're going to be the people who are trapped in the R complex of the brain. Okay? They're going to be the people who are actually doing the physical actions to control others and to enslave others. And that's namely the police and the military and government officials of the world and
schools,
bankers, et cetera. Right. Schools largely try to put people toward the left brain. But then you're going to need a whole nother system to indoctrinate people toward the right brain form of imbalance. And that's religion and the New Age movement. And that's what keeps people inactive, not engaged in the masculine aspects of standing up for your rights, self-defense, action in the world. Okay? So they want to kill all of the positive qualities through imbalancing people toward one hemisphere of the brain or another. And ultimately what that does is build a society that's based in total slavery, which is a male dominator society. Ultimately, the elite themselves are male dominated. They're masculine imbalanced, okay, in their consciousness. And then all the people underneath of them are in some form feminine imbalanced, right brain imbalanced, because they're all taking their orders and acting as their slaves, never breaking their programming and never actually standing up for their own rights and defending themselves against the violence and slavery that's being done to them. So it's a dichotomy. It's a dialectic, a twofold force, a twofold imbalancing that they have to maintain in order to keep this slavery system perpetuated.
Yep. Tell that child who's just been raped and ritually abused and going to bed hungry and sad to love and light it away. Yeah. You know, it's just not going to happen.
And it's not natural. It isn't natural. If somebody is doing something that is actively harming you and you've vocalized or expressed to them in whatever form that you want it to stop and they refuse to stop, ladies and gentlemen, that's called evil. And evil is real. If somebody is willfully continuing to harm another person, that's not just not knowing what is going on or somehow being ignorant. It's beyond that. It's called evil. They know it's bad. They know it's harmful. They felt the result of being harmed by another person in their life. They're willfully taking an action that they know to be wrong, that they know to be causing harm and continuing to cause harm to another person, and that is called evil. And it's very real. It exists in nature. It is going on in our world, and we need to wake up, open our eyes to it, and understand that we cannot allow it to stand, and we need to say no to it, and at some point, we're going to have to rise up in strength and put it down.
Absolutely. And that's what the great work is, isn't it, Mark?
That's exactly what it is. The great work is about ending slavery on this planet. And I'd go farther than that. The true great work is about ending slavery everywhere, everywhere in the manifested reality, everywhere in the manifested universe. Why? Because it's wrong. It's wrong at all times. It's wrong at all places. And it should not be allowed to stand and continue. And the people of the whole universe need to recognize that they need to develop the will to put slavery down and to end it. That is what the real great work is all about. And because that is such a difficult task, and because it involves so much confrontation, people are unwilling and they are loath to do the true great work. That's why the slavery system marches on largely unchallenged. But there are some people now, a small paradigm shift is starting to take place where people are starting to realize they've been lied to by religion, they've been lied to by the New Age movement. And there is an absolute truth regarding right and wrong that exists in nature. And they're going to come online to it, and they're going to understand that what their objective was to learn and to understand in consciousness the whole time, their whole mission spiritually, the whole time that they had been derailed from by these false religions, was to end slavery in the three-dimensional realm that we call the manifested universe. And ultimately, that is what the true great work really is for us to do. That is our spiritual mission. It is what we were derailed from, and it's what we have to get back on track to get done in our reality.
Yes, well, it seems like the whole planet has been MK-Ultra'd, and it's not a mistake that Magdala and the Tavistock Institute has a lot of roots in Satanism.
Of course. I'll let Jay speak to that because that's one of his specialities, particularly Tavistock.
Go right ahead. Jay, Jay, don't worry. We have plenty of time for your presentation.
Okay. Basically, I just wanted to tag on to what Mark just said there, is that, you know, when you listen to what he's saying about consciousness, what are we talking about? We're talking about divide and conquer. Divide and conquer. And the thing is, there has been probably a half dozen men in the last 50 years that has really opened up the true history of the world and the true history of governments and religion. And I just want to give a shout out to the work of a man by the name of John Lash. And if you don't understand religion, if you don't understand the psychological impact of religion, you're not going to understand how this slave system works. And John Lash wrote a book called Not in His Image. And in that book, there's some of the most profound predator, prey, victim, abuser understandings.
Yeah, just look at the altar boys. Just look at these big mass churches that are more like a rock concert. You know, give me money, give me money. It's all, it just makes me insane.
Well, it has nothing to do with spirituality. Basically, it really is herd mentality.
Absolutely.
And if you have not been taught in your subconscious about who you really are, what you're capable of as a human being, what your mission in life is, which is to know the truth, as Jesus Christ said, you are to know the truth and then bear fruit unto it.
That's it.
Yes.
Okay. What's a fruit that the Christian church has been bearing for the last 2,000 years? Well, let me tell you, they never saw an Illuminati jacked up war they didn't like.
Yeah. The only fruit that any of the social institutions of the entire planet Earth has been bearing is the same thing. It's called slavery. That's the only fruit that any of these institutions have borne. That's why we're still in this human condition that is slavery. And that's what people have to understand. It's not about what we need to knew that we need to do. It's the truth is so painful to people because it is about destroying what we are attached to, because it has been up to this point the only way we have been living and interacting with each other. And what has to be done is that false system needs to be destroyed and taken down. It needs to be absolutely, utterly taken down. It's not about what we need to start doing. It's what we have been doing the whole time since we've existed as a species that we need to stop engaging in. It's always about the negative, the no, what we need to say no to. And again, that's a highly unpopular position because people fear the unknown. Well, if we stop doing this, this is all we've ever done. What will we do? Well, if you stop doing this, you won't even need to ask the question, what will we do? Because the condition of freedom that will organically result as a result of what we stop doing will answer the question, what will we do? You'll be free at that point, and you'll be able to create anything you want, because that condition is about infinite possibility, which is being stifled from us right now because we stay attached to the way that we have done things that does not serve who we are in the least bit. Kathy, I'm going to step aside at this point and let Jay launch into his talk that he wants to give to the generational Satanists, dark occultists, quote-unquote Illuminati. I personally don't look at them as the Illuminati, because that means illuminated ones. We are the illuminated ones. We are the people who know the truth about what's going on in the world. These people aren't the illuminated of anything except, the bottom of a sewage can, okay? You know, not even that, you know? So they're not illuminated at all. They're just, I just call them the dark ones, period. If you want to call them the darkly illuminated, go ahead. They have the dark sun in them. You know, they may have the knowledge about what goes on within the human psyche and be able to manipulate that through that knowledge, but that makes it dark knowledge if you're going to use it like that. So that's the dark sun. It has nothing to do with the true spirit of illumination, which is what the people who really are coming online to the truth have born in them. So that's all I really have to say at this point. And I'm going to step aside at this point, let Jay talk to these generational Satanists and give that message, if that's okay.
Yeah, well, let me just say real quick, I kind of coined a term for a lot of people who think they're awake but really aren't awake because they're still serving themselves and not other people. They're sort of in a self-awakened psychosis. They're putting that old addiction into another addiction by wanting to join
themselves into believing that they actually have awoken.
Yes, like the New Age movement.
Right.
You know, they think they're, you know, it's not about going to a conference and ordering stuff online. It's about actually doing the work.
That's
so they're really just fooling themselves.
You're absolutely correct. And, you know, that's just as a little plug, that's the dynamic I'm going to address and speak to at my next seminar in St. Louis, Missouri on May 31st. It's going to be called Streetwise Spirituality. What does it truly mean to be awake? And this is the dynamic I'm actually going to get into in that seminar.
Great. Well, you're more than welcome to use my term, self-awakened psychosis.
Our talk on What on Earth is Happening podcast 146 was all about cognitive dissonance. And it was a great show with Mark and I. And I recommend you want to know about my story, number 17 podcast on What on Earth is Happening, number 100. The Free Your Mind conference videos online for free. And I also have interviews with Jeff Renz and Alfred Weber and several other people out on the web. And I talk in detail about what I experience.
Yeah, they're really good. I saw several of them.
And they're pretty good. You know,
Jay, why don't you break down what you want to say?
Well, this is something I did a few videos with Alex Ansari, and I talked about these issues, and I'm going to quickly state this again to the dark occult. When I grew up in Arden, Delaware, two of my brother John's friends were walking down Harvey Road one day, and they both became occult, and they were talking to one another. I was about 11 and they were about 13. And they said, when we come into power, we'll be given a lot of money. That means when the cult takes over the world, when the Illuminati hammers down and locks down the entire world through the New World Order system, through UN Agenda 21, these 34 million mind control slaves that are the Illuminati minions that work for the DuPonts and Rockefellers in the military industrial complex. They have been told for hundreds and thousands of years, when the dark overlords finally take hold of the planet permanently and shut down all goodness, then they will be paid and they will be like princes on the earth. Well, my parents said something to me in 1963. They said, the elite is going to betray us. And they meant the rank and file Satanists, the 34 million that aren't trillionaires and billionaires, that can't shapeshift. They're going to betray us, because they knew my mother worked for the DuPonts. In fact, my mother was the person that programmed John DuPont to kill in 1991. She put a program in him.
Wow.
And I did a YouTube video about it. It's 45 minutes long, where Buzzware proved John DuPont's mind control. And it took 26 years for the program to finally launch. That's knowing something about the cycles of humanity biologically and knowing about mind control. The Illuminati have been doing mind control since the days of Atlantis. That's why my father said we're Atlantean warlocks. Okay? Mm-hmm. So they know, but when you're a minion, And I say anyone with less than $500 billion, don't expect to get a place in the underground nirvana if they decide to
exactly create
the world. I mean, we're talking about the book Superclass.
There's no room at the inn for us.
Yeah. Yeah. And I'm talking to people that know the score, the dark occult that are doing the raping and pillaging right now to poison the morphogenic field. Okay. This system is held up by the 10% of the working class and upper middle class elite that are doing the bidding of you know, the top of the pyramid. If they stand down, the system falls. But in order for the mind control to be effective over the masses of humanity, they have to rape and torture. That's why 800,000 children go missing in America every year, okay, into the pedophile clubs, into the dungeons, into death, okay? They need that constant terror into the morphogenic fields, into the lines.
Because that's how they harness their power, right?
Yeah. We're epigenetic creatures. And if you listen, and I'm talking to the dark occult right now, you've been thrown under the bus. You drank the fluoride. You've seen what happened to the schools. You're not getting paid, okay? Let's be honest here. The Shangri-La you were promised ain't going to happen. The elite may build a Tesla spacecraft and leave. They may strip the ozone layer off the planet. And this is something I want to talk to them directly about right now. There is geoengineering going on the planet right now.
Absolutely.
This is solar radiation management, okay? This is stratospheric aerosol geoengineering, where you are spraying with airplanes nanoparticulate, aluminum, barium, manganese, and fluoride, other chemicals, biological components. The ozone, and you're going to have to do some research on this. The ozone is now depleted 40%, plus there are two major holes over the Arctic and the Antarctic. If the spraying continues, there will be no life on the planet in the Northern Hemisphere in less than 17 years.
And it's also working in unison with HAARP.
To destroy the planet. It's absolutely about weather control.
And mind control.
Yes. But the thing that I want to stress to people tonight in the Illuminati minions that have worked for generations for that big payday, forget about it. Okay? You know you've been thrown under the bus. You're eating the GMO. You're drinking the fluoride. Okay? Your children are getting the vaccines, the bad schooling, the mind control on TV. Don't think that just because you're a jail guard in the prison, you're somebody special. You're nothing but a dog with a dog tag.
Yeah, it's almost like they have been MK'd themselves.
Absolutely. I mean, we're talking about just a one step up the ladder from the lowest of the low of the unwashed masses of humanity. That's what we're talking about here.
Yeah.
So instead of being in the cell, you get to be a prison guard. That's it. That's all it is for you. And now they are destroying the ecology of the planet. 200 million tons of geoengineering aerosol is being sprayed each year, and this has been going on since 2001. The acidification of the oceans, now the plankton in the oceans is down 50%. The sea life in the oceans is now down to 10% of what it used to be. The ozone is down 40%. The stratospheric aerosol geoengineering is tearing the ozone apart. When they give you a bunch of shit that they're geoengineering to save us from global warming, just take a look in reality. What happened this winter? This winter, it was 55 degrees in Alaska, and it was 4 degrees in Philadelphia. Okay? They used HAARP and the geoengineering aerosol to bend the jet stream. So the cold left the Arctic region and came down here. There is 50 gigatons of methane in Siberia and the Arctic underneath the oceans. You need to do some research here because we're talking about the elite, and my parents said this in 1963, was going to betray the rank and file. And that means if you're a college professor, if you've got a PhD, let me tell you, if you're not old school, dark Venetian, Babylonian bloodline, and we're talking trillionaires here, you're not going anywhere but to the grave with the rest of the unwashed masses of humanity.
You got to be okay? The top 1%.
It's not even that.
Really?
200. I would say that the elite have made preparations probably for about 200,000 of their top people, and then a cadre of mind control slaves. That's it. You know, I could be wrong, but I'm telling you right now, the planet only has maybe 15 years left to it. Okay. There is a website called ameg.me. It goes into the amount of methane that is now being released in the Arctic. Okay. When they bent the jet stream this winter, okay. Now, they're saying they're doing geoengineering to cool the planet, to protect the ice cap. But, in fact, they're bending the jet stream so the cold in the Arctic comes down to the 48, lower 48, and the moisture and the warmth from Hawaii and the Pacific goes racing up to the Arctic during the winter. This is going to release enough methane to kill everything on the surface of the planet. It will rip up the ozone, will be ripped apart by the barium and aluminum. The methane will cause the global warming.
And that's if we don't stop. Is that if we don't stop them, Jay?
If we don't stop the geoengineering now, the methane is 23 times more powerful. Okay, 23 times more powerful a greenhouse gas than methane frozen Arctic and in Siberia right now. And you can go to ameg.me right now and watch a few videos, and you will see that. What they did with HAARP and the geoengineering manipulation this winter was to warm up the Arctic during the cold time so that some massive amounts of mass will be used. They can go into their deep underground technology. They may even have interdimensional or, spacecraft right now due to Tesla technology. But the thing is, what I want to say to the people in the dark occult, you've got nothing in continuing to do these rituals that keep the entire human race in mind control.
Well, Bigelow's got that first privatized space station already.
Well, I mean, people are planning for the future. You don't have one. You know, you're all just playing cognitive dissonance. You're not looking at the elephant in the living room.
Yeah.
Okay? The elite, my mother found out from the top of the elite, the DuPont family, which, of course, they are part of the Council of 13, that the elite was going to throw the rank and file under the... What I'm saying to the people in the cult, look at my Free Your Mind 1 conference video. Get Wisdom of Yourselves by Bruce Lipton. start to learn about the trivium and start doing some critical thinking. Do EFT to break down the programming in your subconscious. Eat organically and start to get stronger physically, so the urges of the physical desire to engage in some of these rituals, the chemical imbalance, will be broken down through eating better, through exercising. But number one, using EFT to reprogram your subconscious. You can also use another technique called Psy-K. But I'm telling you right now that you're headed for the ash heap of history, just like the unwashed masses of humanity.
Unless we act on it.
And what are you getting out of this? I mean, since the assassination of John F. Kennedy, the Illuminati in the West have ruled unchallenged.
I agree.
And I'm sorry, but I know people in Arden who are cult, and I don't see them running around in Bentleys. Okay? So where was the promised nirvana? It never happened. So human consciousness is being poisoned through the rituals that are done by the 34 million dark occultists. And if you don't understand what I'm talking about, and I'm talking to the dark occultists now, it's because in the compartmentalization of the pyramidal dark occult system, you were not told the whole story. You were not told the truth. And I'm telling you the truth right now. And what you need to find out is who you are and what you are and where you are. You know you're in a matrix, you know you're in a holodeck, but this holodeck is run on consciousness. That's why they spend trillions of dollars social engineering and mind controlling through religion and mainstream media. You know all about this. You know the news on the TV is a joke. Now, you were always told you had to do these rituals to satisfy the aliens, or they would destroy the human race. Well, take a look at geoengineeringwatch.org. Geoengineeringwatch.org. Take a look at AMEG.me and learn about the methane in the Arctic. We are out of time. I do not know what the elite have planned, whether they are going to develop a Tesla technology spacecraft and leave, or whether they're going to incinerate through destroying the ozone and releasing the methane, the entire planet, and go underground for 10,000 years or whatever. Don't know. But I know this. Without an ozone layer, we don't have life. And the amount of methane that is frozen up in Siberia and the Arctic is three times the amount of hydrocarbons in the rest of the planet. You take all the shale, all the coal, all the shale oil, all the natural gas and the oil, the methane hydrocarbon amount up in Siberia that's being released right now due to the global warming, due to the depletion of the ozone, okay, is three times what the total hydrocarbon of the planet is. The last time this methane got released into the environment on Earth, it took the Earth 19 million years to recover. And I'm just saying, go to my Free Your Mind One talk, and I recommend exactly where you have to go and what you have to do to reprogram yourself. But if I were you, I wouldn't do another thing for the elite, because they have betrayed an ancient blood oath. And I am ashamed that you are still working for them.
Yes. Well, we have to go soon, but I want to rapid fire some questions at you both, if that's okay. And Neil's got a question for you too. I know you advocate organite to combat some of this energy, right, Jay?
Oh, absolutely. I make organite, and you know, that's a whole other discussion of mind control we didn't get into with the cell towers.
Yeah, the cell towers definitely beaming a scalar technology at us, and radio waves and all that other crazy stuff. It's through our televisions and et cetera, et cetera. It's just
that's
insane.
Why I don't watch TV, and my parents were avid TV watchers.
Do you advocate the use of cannabis to break free from mind control?
I personally, you know, this is another thing that we talk about in the 146 podcast on what on earth is happening. The cognitive dissonance. We have talked for how many years about curing cancer? Yet, if you do a 10-minute search for cancer cures on the web, you'll find pure THC oil cures all terminal cancers. That there's baking soda to cure cancer. That there's a half dozen plants out there that have like apricot kernels that cure cancer. Yet 500,000 people a year die of cancer in America alone. That's cognitive dissonance. We're living in la-la land. Or as the Anunnaki would say, we're living in Lulu land.
Yeah. Now, why don't we have Mark talk briefly about, or whoever would like to take this topic, about Bohemian Grove and some of the mock sacrifices that are actually real sacrifices.
Yeah, what that entire ritual is all about is it's an ancient Babylonian and Assyrian and Canaanite absolution ritual, which is about the forgiveness of it's about self-forgiveness for what you are about to do to people in the way of doing them harm in the coming year. So they go to that grove in Northern California, and they essentially gather and perform a ritual called the cremation of care. What they're doing is that they are immolating their conscience. They are immolating their care so it doesn't weigh heavily, the conscience doesn't weigh heavily upon them in the coming year, so that they will be unfettered to then go and do whatever they have to do that they are commanded to do by, you know, their cult by in the coming year. So, and they keep going and doing this on a yearly basis because, again, the conscience is a force that is strong and keeps trying to reemerge and come back up. It's a natural tendency. And most of these people aren't primary psychopaths that are working with them. In many cases, they're not psychopathic, or if they are, they are secondarily psychopathic, meaning that they're not genetic. They don't have genetic psychopathy or what's called primary psychopathy. They have the ability to feel, it's just being repressed. It's being repressed by all the justifications that they offer for why they have to continue to do the actions that they are engaged in. So that's really what that ritual is about. And it's a very, very powerfully entrancing ritual because of how much attention and energy is focused in that grove area each year. So I would suggest that that's also something that is done in effigy out in the fore, in the front. You know, if you look at the layout through the video that was taken of that region where they perform that ritual, where the ceremony takes place that the public sees, I would say that is only the mock aspect of it. I would say behind there's a real priest class that is actually engaged in a real sacrifice. The mock sacrifice is only for, again, the lower level minions in that organization get to watch the mock sacrifice, but only the high level priest class gets to engage in the real sacrifice. So that's what my take on Bohemian Grove is. And I would definitely say these are absolutely generational Satanists that are running the show there and using people and giving them these promises. The rank and file, as Jay would call them, are the people who are engaged in the mock ritual and just watching it. And they're on the outside of things.
Well, I've seen some footage from Bohemian Grove that wasn't supposed to get out of Bohemian Grove, and they you know, who knows? They had a person wrapped up in some kind of cover. Mm-hmm. So that could be someone who's under mind control or who's, you know, being sacrificed right there in front of everyone.
Sure.
For all we know.
It's very possible. I tend to lean to the side that that's simply a mock ritual that's happening and a real sacrifice is taking place behind the scenes by the real priest class.
Yeah,
that's
right.
Just the dog and pony show, you could say, to trot out there to focus the attention that is then going to be redirected for the real ritual.
There's a question that my audio technician who's on the call now would like to ask one of you. He said he was wondering if the Illuminati fear any forms of spirituality, religion, faiths, disciplines, etc. Like, is there such a thing as an anti-Illuminati?
They only fear one thing, truth. And the frequency that truth protects the human species with if we step into its power. That's the only thing I would suggest that they are truly in fear of, because that is the thing that can actually free humanity and end slavery if we accept it.
Absolutely.
I'd like to add something on that. My mother was looking at the moon when we were heading to Buzz Ware's gallery, where we were raped and tortured. And it was after church on Sunday. We went to two churches. And the moon was out. It was a fall afternoon, and the moon was like a half moon. And she looked at it, and she said, you know, I've been talking to Buzz about studying about the Dakini of the moon, which is the goddess mythology and religion. And my father almost stopped the car and looked at her like he couldn't believe it. And he looked at her and said, the Dakini, that's the goddess. She'll kill us. And I had never seen my father give any respect, especially to Christianity. He said it's holy, all right, holy full of crap. And basically, the only thing he feared was the goddess. And if you read John Lash's book, Not in His Image, you will understand a lot of the psychology of the goddess. And I really believe that, as far as what is out there, my mother talked about the goddess and the same way John Lash does. And there's something to the goddess.
I personally see the goddess as truth. I see that as the feminine force that we have to come to accept and stop, engaging in our completely calcified ego identification. When we do that, we're actually accepting the goddess force into our life, and that force is truth. That is the frequency of truth, and that is why they fear it so much, because they know that the truth, if you want to feminize it like that, is the only power that if we step into ultimately protects us from them, because stepping into the truth is saying no to evil. That's what we're doing. We're refusing to say yes to evil anymore because we recognize what's true and what's not true. And we're saying to this force that keeps trying to entice us to get us to do its bidding, we're saying, get lost. We don't want to be around you. Get behind me. And, we're going to be finished with that once we accept truth into our lives. You know, and that's when real transformation is going to take place, when that level of real, true awakening takes place.
Absolutely. And I just want to say that, you know, in my 14 years since I woke up, knowledge and wisdom and learning and growing has been the most powerful healer for me. It's not just the EFT. It's not just eating organically. It's changing what I'm living for. Okay. One of the things in the mind control of this planet is people give up hope even in themselves. And they just say, oh, it's too much of a bother. It's too big a mountain to climb. And I'm telling the people in the dark occult that think that they're helplessly trapped in that lifestyle, you do not owe the cult jack. The Illuminati elite have totally thrown you under the bus. And let me tell you, with all the different media outlets that are out there, if you don't want to rape and kill anymore, you can just say to them, hey, you know something? We were promised Nirvana and we're not getting it. You know.
Yeah, Jay, you stated that there's a lot of bodies in the Arden Woods.
My mother said in 1963 that the woods were full of bodies.
Is that from Sacrifice?
Yeah. And also, it's a Illuminati dumping ground.
Wow.
Because in business, you know, you have to do things.
Yeah, sadly, that is their business.
But I'm saying to the people that, you know, are in the cult, you know, you need to get together with the people. And I'm talking to the people in Arden and Rose Valley and stuff. And I'm saying you've got to end your cognitive dissonance and look at reality. What really is going on? You are being murdered with the planet and the unwashed masses of humanity. This is the end for all of us. Do the research. Look at the methane. Look at the geoengineering. Look at the GMO. Look at the vaccines. Look at the fake cancer cures. You know, this is a eugenics meat grinder.
They have all the bases covered, don't they?
Yes, they do, except one base, and that's the human spirit.
Absolutely. Right. Well, Jay, why don't you mention your show so the listeners can follow you there?
Well, my show is SRA Today. It's on Sunday night, 7 to 9 Eastern, and it's a blog talk show on the Type 1 Radio Ashram. And basically what I do is I collect interesting articles that I find on the web pertaining to consciousness, healing, personal growth, and politics too. Sometimes I talk about the next big fake war that the bankers are setting up, like the Ukraine situation. And, you know, I take calls and I talk to people.
Excellent. And Mark, why don't you mention what you'd like to mention about your website?
Sure. My main website is whatonearthishappening.com. There's a tremendous body of knowledge up there. There's hundreds of podcasts up there. There are videos up there. I always recommend to people to go to the podcast section and listen in order at your own pace so that you get the full tapestry of what I have been laying out on that site for many years. I highly recommend watching my natural law seminar. I think it's probably the most powerful work I've done to date and absolutely critical and essential information for people to understand contained in those three videos. And I do a radio show every Saturday evening on the Republic Broadcasting Network from 10 p.m. to 1 a.m. Eastern Time. And you could, again, listen live on whatonearthishappening.com.
Well, I'd like to say in closing, I have a lot of respect for both of you, for what you've been through and what you've rose above in your lives, and your passion for the truth and holding the frequency that you do hold.
If we step into the power of truth, the entire universe will come to our assistance.
Absolutely.
Kathy, thank you so much for what you do as well.
Thank you. Thank you both for being here.
You're more than welcome.
It's great. It's great. Hopefully sometime this summer we can all hang out again. That'll be fun.
Sounds great.
All right. Okay, everyone. In closing, I would like to quote Yoko Ono. She stated, "Healing yourself is connected with healing others." In my opinion, that's what both of our guests try to accomplish by speaking out on a daily basis. Tonight's ending song is by Villains Like You. We also feature their music in the intro you heard tonight, so we thank them for that. More of their music can be found at Reverb Nation. The song is titled Red Sun. On behalf of myself and the Truth Connections team, thank you all very much for being here. Until next time, be safe, be good to each other. Peace. We'll be right back.
time go? Time we used to know. You lost it like gambling, original sin. Try to get away. Sin. Where's your love been? It's been sown. Hold on to it while you can. Original sin.